The Chinese Communist Party, or CCP, has long sought to subvert America. A number of the groups involved in recent riots have ideological ties to Beijing. But what are the deeper connections? According to Heritage Foundation senior fellow Mike Gonzalez, the Black Futures Lab, closely linked to the Black Lives Matter global movement, is being funded by an openly pro-CCP group.
And the Black Futures Lab, if you go to the donate button, says that the money you give will go to the Chinese Progressive Association of San Francisco.
In this episode, Gonzalez reveals exactly what he found, why recent fact checks of his work have proven inaccurate, and why he believes identity politics is undermining the very foundations of American society. This is American Thought Leaders, and I'm Jekielek.
Michael Gonzalez, such a pleasure to have you on American Thought Leaders.
Jan, the pleasure is all mine.
So you've written a very, very interesting book just out recently, The Plot to Change America, How Identity Politics is Dividing the Land of the Free, a topic we've covered quite a bit on American Thought Leaders, broadly speaking. Before we go in there, I want to talk to you about this recent article that you've written, finding a connection between the Black Lives Matter founder and pro-Chinese Communist Party groups in America. And this is pretty fascinating because there's been people alleging these kinds of connections. There's some ideological overlap, but this is the first time a kind of financial connection was discovered.
Well, yes, the overlap is ideological, definitely. One has to realize that this founder, Alicia Garza, sits atop a worldwide revolutionary network. It's really a holding company for revolutionary cells. One of the main ones, which she founded, is the Black Lives Matter Global Network. Now, I have to make clear that nobody is against the sentiment that Black Lives Matter. In fact, I think all Americans adhere, at any rate, should adhere to the fact that Black lives, of course, do indeed matter. We're talking about the organizations. So Alicia Garza is one of the founders of these organizations. And in 2018, she founded yet another one called the Black Futures Lab. And the Black Futures Lab, if you go to the donate button, says that the money you give will go to the Chinese Progressive Association of San Francisco. The Chinese Progressive Association of San Francisco is an organization that has done that has pushed the Chinese, the Beijing line in San Francisco, that has taken some actions that would benefit the People's Republic of China. But the main thing is that its leaders, many of its leaders, are members of Left Root. Left Root is an organization of the hard left, in which a lot of people, the Chinese Progressive Association of Boston, its leaders are also members of Left Root, and I think that's where the ideological overlap is with Alicia Garza and the Black Lives Matter organization, because Alicia Garza is a Marxist, has said that she needs to smash capitalism, has said this several times. I just viewed a video this morning of the two other founders, Opal Tometi and Patrice Couleurs, chanting, we have nothing to lose but our chains, which is obviously straight out of the Communist Manifesto. So I think the overlap, the Venn diagram overlap between the Black Lives Matter organizations, Alicia Garza, and groups like CPA San Francisco is this.
No, it's very interesting. And but you actually found that there's this, there's a financial connection between CPA and this new organization that Alicia Garza founded.
Yes, the Black Futures Lab is a fiscally sponsored project of the San Francisco CPA. I think that a lot of the Black Lives Matter organizations are fiscally sponsored projects of one thing or another, because that gives them a degree of flexibility in how opaque they can be and how they spend their money. That's what the critics have said. For example, the Black Lives Matter Global Network used to be a fiscally sponsored project of Thousand Currents. Thousand Currents is another funder of the hard left. And then it emerged in July because of research that was done by people here in Washington, that the vice chairman of the board of 1,000 Currents, Susan Rosenberg, who used to be a member of the Weather Underground, which the FBI identified as a domestic terrorist organization. She spent time in prison. Susan Rosenberg, her sentence was commuted by Bill Clinton in his last day in office, and here she is sitting on the board of 1,000 Currents. So after this emerges, Black Lives Matter Global Network, which is very media savvy, became a fiscally sponsored project of the Tides Center, which is also a very a funder of the hard left, but at least it doesn't have Susan Rosenberg on its board.
So Michael, you mentioned a couple of different organizations. You mentioned a San Francisco CPA and a Boston CPA, obviously different organizations. What actually ties these groups to the Chinese Communist Party?
Well, they were both created by Ai Weiquan. Ai Weiquan was a hard Marxist militant organization in the 60s, which created the San Francisco CPA in 1972. Some of the IWK people went and created this, the CPA in Boston in 1977. They're separately registered and separately run. Its members are connected through organizations such as Left Roots, which is a Marxist organization.
Right.
Both of them, the CPA in Boston has done events with the Chinese consulate in Boston, with the Chinese consulate in New York, but the events have taken place in Boston. And the CPA in San Francisco has taken steps to defend the People's Republic of China. For example, they were part of an organization in 1977 that urged the Department of Justice not to investigate Chinese spying in America, that's spying by China. And they used the specious pretext that this was racial profiling. I must say that in this particular instance, they combined with a group that was for affirmative action, which shows that they're not really working in the interests of Chinese Americans. Chinese Americans are one of the groups that is worst affected by racial profiling in university admissions. In fact, the very Chinese American parents are very activated all across the country trying to fight racial preferences.
So you mentioned to me when we were speaking offline that you had like three kind of lines of evidence that show the connection.
Well, I have that I just mentioned. Then there was the fact that Alex Tom was part of an excursion organization trying to bring people in China and the United States together. I looked at it and it looked like he was trying to find the leftist Americans, trying to put them together with the most leftist elements within the People's Republic of China. And then there was the third instance in which the CPA San Francisco joined a letter to the Biden campaign saying we want you to beat, you know, President Trump in the election, but we urge you not to engage in any China bashing. And if you engage in any China bashing, this is going to cost you at the polls. The letter actually said that. So I have no idea why an organization such as this would go to bat for the People's Republic of China, telling a candidate not to engage in criticism of China.
That's really, really interesting. There's been a fact check of sorts that was published recently about your article, which as it became popular, as it gained some traction on social media, that there is this connection. So what is your response to that?
Well, the New York Times, they are very eager to hide the Marxist roots of the Black Lives Matter organizations and its founders. And what I said is, look, it's no surprise. The New York Times covered for communists in the Soviet Union in the 30s when it denied the genocide in Ukraine. The New York Times also covered for communists in Cuba when Herbert Matthew went down there and described the rebels as Democrats who were not Marxists in the least. And the New York Times is now engaging in the same practice here in the United States by trying to describe Black Lives Matter as a movement that is not Marxist at all. And this is it's parsing issues here, because obviously the people who turn out to demonstrate, who are outraged by the manner in which George Floyd died,
they're not Marxist. They're just outraged by the death of a fellow American. And so they go out and they demonstrate, and they're not, but the way they're being manipulated by these organizations is the issue here. These organizations, as I've said, and the New York Times cannot deny this as much as it wants to, you know, Alicia Garza, Patrice Couleurs especially, are trained Marxists. They say that themselves. Patrice Couleurs, for example, trained at the Labor Community Strategy Center that was founded by Eric Mann, another former member of the Weather Underground, who calls that center a center for revolutionaries, a center where he trains revolutionaries. She trained there for many years. Alicia Garza also has said many times that capitalism has to be smashed because capitalism is racist, which is the opposite of the truth, obviously. Capitalism rewards. Capitalism is just a fancy word for I have bought something. I have bought this cup with the sweat of my brow, and you want to buy it. We both agree on a price, and we both walk away happy. In other words, it's another word for freedom, right? It's a Marxist word for freedom. It's colorblind. It's the least racist thing at all. It lifts up all people. But yet, Alicia Garza says this, and as I said earlier, I believe there's a video of Paul Tometi and Patrice Couleurs chanting, "We have nothing to lose but our chains," which is out of Karl Marx. And also, all three of them praise Joanne Chesimard, who now goes by the name of Sata Shakur, who is the number one on the FBI wanted list, who is a fugitive for having killed a cop who fled prison and is now has been given asylum in communist Cuba, wanted by the U.S. They praise her all the time, all three of them.
Given what you've told me already, right about the connection between the CPA and BLM, what is the New York Times trying to say here?
The New York Times is trying to obfuscate the fact that the CPA in San Francisco, which has taken pro-China stands, is the fiscal sponsor of a BLM organization because there's an ideological overlap. So Left Roots is not just left of center. Left Roots is a very hard lefty organization, you know, that groups people around the world who want world revolution. When you publish in Left Roots, when you meet in Left Roots, when you speak at Left Roots, you are a bona fide, you know, charter member of the hard left.
In this article, Fact Checking the Fact Checker, you actually cite our columnist, Trevor Loudon, who I think he describes the CPAs as Maoist organizations. Can you speak to that? What does that mean?
Well, I mean, from the beginning, that's one of the main things. So CPA is founded by Roy Quinn in 1972. We have to remember, 1972 is the height of the Cultural Revolution. Cultural Revolution is lasting in China between 66 and 76. So 72 is more or less a halfway point. This organization is founded to support the PRC in the United States, especially in San Francisco, obviously in San Francisco and its very large Chinatown, to convince the American public to switch recognition of China from Taiwan to the Communist People's Republic of China. They're inspired by the revolution. Again, at the height of the craziness of the Cultural Revolution, they find the inspiration in this. It's coincidental, or perhaps not, that many people are comparing what we're seeing in our streets today to the Red Guards of that time, of the Cultural Revolution, and they're saying that we're going through the same type of Cultural Revolution, and we're seeing this, for example, with the struggle sessions that are being held in Maoist Cultural Revolution term, but we have the same things in the anti-racism training, which are nothing but struggle sessions in which people must confess their sins, people must be made to atone for things they haven't done, for sins they haven't committed. The idea of collective sin or the sins of one's ancestors, carrying the sins of one's ancestors, anybody who understands anything about religion understands that you do not commit the sins of your grandfather, you do not carry them with you. But I'm very happy to note along those lines that President Trump has banned these struggle sessions at least from the federal workforce, although I heard the State Department, it persists in going ahead with one of these struggle sessions, and we'll see whether the administration is able to stop them. I think they should be gone. They, especially corporate America, has embraced these things in a rush to show good intentions, as have other elements of our society. These are things that are straight out of the Maoist playbook.
So, you know, you mentioned this idea that this, I guess, the sin is kind of actually tied to identity in this construct, basically who you're, what the color of your skin you're born with, what gender you are. My question for you is, let's jump to your book now.
Right.
Right? Because your book actually speaks directly to these things. It's not surprising that you're writing on this topic. Tell me about your book.
So the book, I call it The Plot to Change America. That's the title. How identity politics is dividing the land of the free, because that is the tool that is used to change America, right? Identity politics is a tool. What does identity politics do? Identity politics divides the country into groups that are based on either race or ethnicity or sex or sexual orientation or gender identity, even disability status. Anything that confers a claim on victimhood. And then you can use this victimhood to demand attention, respect, dignity, but reward, compensatory justice, restitution, all these things. This does two things. First, it puts victimhood on a hamster wheel where the hamster never tires. The hamster keeps running because if you derive everything that is good, respect and attention and rewards from your degree of victimhood, you don't want to do anything to solve your victimhood. Number two, though, and that's the important thing, that's to the people who want to change America, this the number two thing is the important thing, is these grievances become a catalyst to change society, because the promise is held that the victimhood will end when these collectives change the country. They say the country is structurally racist, institutionally racist, systemically racist, and therefore all the structures, all the institutions in the system being a word for the way everything works, have to be changed. So it is it's not a coincidence that all these people despise capitalism, despise freedom, they despise most of our natural rights. The right to say, the right to free speech is connected to how much money you have, that the right to property, they especially dislike that one. The right to freedom of conscience is another one they go against. So what they want to do is take us from a country that is based on natural rights, that derives its legitimacy from natural rights and the belief that governments are instituted among men to protect their natural rights, into one where the collectivities replace the individual as the agents of social change, as the agent of everything, and then what they want to do is take us into central planning. Central planning being where the government really decides everything for us. If you don't have your own property, if you don't have your individual agency, the government becomes the one that orders society. And that's really at the end of what they want, to take us to a model that is completely un-American in the sense that nothing that the founders conceived allows for such a thing.
So individual agency has no place in this?
No, individual agency, in fact, they are very specific about this. Robin DiAngelo, who's one of these, who wrote White Fragility, one of these anti-racism training, her book is on the bestseller list, but all of them emphasize, and from the beginning, by the way, this is a feature of the system, that they say, yeah, the individual can improve his lot. We accept this. The individual, through hard work and the application of his faculties, will improve his lot, can change his status, can go from working class to middle class, can even become rich. But that is not what we want. We don't want the individual to become better, to improve his lot in life. What we want is to change society through collective action.
Run that by me again.
Yes, they say specifically that, and yes, they say it in different ways, but I'll give you a version of this, is that it doesn't matter if the individual can improve his lot in life through hard work. That they accept that is the case.
Okay, but they don't care.
They don't want this, because that is the individual joining a system they dislike. When the individual does that, and I explain this in my book thoroughly and through many of the chapters, when the individual improves his lot, the individual, Antonio Gramsci, wrote about this, is the culture of the theory of cultural hegemony, that he came to understand that even though Marx and Engels had promised that the working class would be revolting everywhere and overthrowing the bourgeoisie, this never came to happen because the worker had accepted the cultural givens of his oppressor, had accepted religion, had accepted the economic system, had accepted the family structure, had accepted religion. The workers had accepted all these things. They had false consciousness, in the words of the communists. So they had to go through consciousness-raising struggle sessions. Again, struggle sessions. This is what we see. It's about changing your consciousness. It's about replacing all these ideas that you have accepted. When the individual joins the system and improves his status and improves his family status, is no longer poor, becomes middle class or even wealthy, the individual has then joined the system. All these people from Gramsci to Marcuse to Angela Davis to Robin DiAngelo to Ibram Kendi to Patrice Cullors, they all say this, that they accept the individual can do this, but they don't want this. They don't want the individual joining the system. They want the individual to join the collective to overthrow the system.
I think you mentioned earlier that a lot of the people that are participating, that have participated in, you know, the Black Lives Matter protests are not people who actually understand that what they're actually getting behind with this.
I would imagine that, I don't know, because many, many young people today say they don't mind Marxism. I don't know if they understand what Marxism really means. I think they think it's Denmark or Sweden, which is not. These are capitalist countries filled with billionaires. But I would imagine that the vast majority of the people joining the protests are just outraged, as I said, by the video they saw, by the idea that this could happen to an American. They didn't like they didn't like what they saw, and rightly so, right? I mean, that was a very harrowing video. Anybody would be outraged by it, but I don't think they understand that what these organizations and their leaders say they want to do.
It's it's very what you described earlier, you know, accepting the existence of agency but basically denying it and saying, you know, we can't have any part of that. That's very counterintuitive, and it's a very kind of abstract concept.
They don't deny agency. They want to transfer agency from the individual to the group. So you stop being an individual, and your relevance is as member of a group, as a Hispanic, or as an African American, or as an Asian American. Let's not forget, by the way, and I devote several chapters to this in my book, that Hispanics and Asian Americans are two categories that were created by these activists. They came into being, and these activists really intimidated the bureaucracy in the 70s. I describe it in my book, The Plot to Change America. They intimidated the bureaucracy into creating, officializing these categories, putting them so that they do so. They finally get the big win when OMB, the Office of Management and Budget, issues Directive Number 15, saying that the old government offices will then have to categorize people as either Hispanic or Asian Americans. They create what is known in the industry as the ethno-racial pentagon: whites, blacks, Hispanics, Asian Americans, and Native Americans. And then they put them on the census in 1980. But let's think about who Asians are. Asians are people as Americans with ancestors in China or India or Sri Lanka or the Philippines or Korea or Japan or Indonesia. People with very different backgrounds, very, very different histories, very different everything, very different cultural habits, very different cultural indicators. The same thing for Hispanics. You have people who are Mexican or Cuban or Argentine or Dominican Republic, people who can be of African descent, people who can be of European descent, people who can be of Native American descent, or a mix thereof, according to the country and the society they come from, and with very different cultural givens. So these categories are artificial to begin with, never mind the sexual categories. The 57 that the state of the city of New York recognizes, apparently, no, I think New York is 37. So these are the membership in these victimhood categories has the agency now rather than the individual acting on his own as an individual, a member of his family, a member of his community, and an American.
How is it that this, you know, very theoretical, I guess, idea actually came, I guess, into the mainstream?
Well, as I said, Antonio Gramsci, the founder of Italy's Communist Party, is thrown into prison by Mussolini in the 1920s, as the prosecutor says, to stop his brain from working. That's a really awful idea. We know from the example of St. Paul and many other people that you do a lot of hard thinking and good writing in prison. And so he comes up with this idea of cultural hegemony. The worker buys it, so we need to have to change the consciousness of the worker. Then the next step is the Frankfurt School. Max Horkheimer and Theodore Adorno write a book in 1937, which comes up with the idea of critical theory. Critical theory becomes the tool by which you affect the change the cultural hegemony with the counter hegemony. Because critical theory is nothing but an unremitting attack on all the norms and traditions of the West. Everything from the family, everything that Gramsci had discovered the worker had adhered to, then critical theory criticizes all this. They pretend that they criticize everything, that they also criticize communism. But as Martin Jay, who wrote a very sympathetic history of the Frankfurt School, as he himself notes in his book, no, they don't really criticize the Soviet Union, even though it's at the height of the purges, at the height of the genocide and the famines. They criticize really only the West. Then people like Herbert Marcuse, who is a critic who's also of the Frankfurt School, he comes to the United States, and he notices he's despairing also about the American worker, right? The American worker is a boob who just likes his hi-fi and likes his split-level home and his refrigerator. He's never going to revolt. But then he notices the riots that are happening in the 60s. Many, you know, hundreds of riots took place between 65 and 71. And he says, it's with these identities, with people of other colors, that we're going to have the agents of change. And he then introduces his idea of this will be the new agents of change. And then you have the other activists are very influenced by these writings demanding the creation of categories. Now, you may say, well, who reads Gramsci these days? Well, critical theory is taught at all levels at the university today. It has different versions, critical race theory, it has critical legal theory, ethnic studies are part of this. Angela Davis has called, black studies, African studies, the intellectual arm of the revolution. And she knows what she's talking about. She knows that this is how you change minds. And let me just do some genealogy here, by the way. Angela Davis was directly taught by Marcuse. Marcuse was her professor. Marcuse was taught by Martin Heidegger. Martin Heidegger was a member of the Nazi Party in Germany, and his major subject was Nietzsche. Nietzsche, and he was a friend of Nietzsche's sister. In fact, Nietzsche's sister makes him the curator of the Nietzsche archives in the 1930s. Nietzsche is the one that invents this idea that there is no truth. There are only narratives. That what is good is what the master class likes and finds beautiful, and what is bad is what the master class finds ugly and bad. And that they impose this on the lower class over whom they have a right to rule. So there's a direct line from Nietzsche to Heidegger to Marcuse to Angela Davis. And who do Patrice Couleurs and Opal Tometi and Alicia Garza claim as one of the most important mentors? Angela Davis. You should see how effusive Alicia Garza thanks Angela Davis in a video for the work that she has done to influence her thinking. Angela Davis, again, spent time in prison for her association with the killing of a cop. She was let out on a technicality in the early 70s. She toured Havana, where she was lionized. She was given the Lenin Peace Prize by East Germany, the most repressive regime behind the Iron Curtain. So when I say they're Marxists, I'm not making any of this up. Angela Davis goes to universities today where she fills auditoriums, and she tells the students, I'm a communist and I have always been a communist. And they rise up and clap.
So basically, you're saying that what was once class struggle has now turned into race and many other categories of struggle.
Class struggle has been left behind because it didn't work. You can change your class. The individual can change his class. That was the problem. What you cannot change is your race, your country of origin, and get ready for this, your sex. You cannot, these are immutable traits. So you put the locus of this in these immutable characteristics. But then another important thing that happens, Marcuse is mentor also to Rudi Dutschke, who's a German revolutionary, and he's the one that comes up with the idea of the long march through the institutions, which Marcuse blesses and said, this is the right thing to do. The long march is obviously a reference to Mao, and Mao's long march with communist partisans in the 30s, when they end up defeating the nationalists in 1949, as you know. But what Rudi Dutschke says is that we're going to have a long march through the institutions that is peaceful. We're going to take over the institutions, the commanding heights of the culture-making institutions, and therefore influence society. The left today is in charge of the academy, the left today is in charge of the media, and the left today is in charge of the entertainment business, with few and notable exceptions, obviously, present company excluded. But the left has done a wonderful job of marching through the institutions.
So I think the last chapter in your book talks about, I believe, like why all this matters.
That's the penultimate chapter.
It
matters because, first of all, this is not just alien to the American system. It is the antithesis of the American system. The American system, as I said, the founders of the country and the framers of the Constitution in 87 base their ideas on people like William Blackstone, whom they quote, on John Locke, whom they quote, on Montesquieu, whom they quote, and their ideas of natural rights, which I have gone over, that we have a few of them. These are rights that are discoverable by us through our faculty of reason, that we can find in nature, that we know we have these rights when we think about them, that we're born with them. In fact, Jefferson says in the Declaration that it's God himself that has endowed us with these rights. You don't have to be a Christian or a believer. You can just say, well, they're in nature. They precede government, the apolitical, the pre-political, and they base everything on that. They have, from Montesquieu, the tension, the division of power among the different branches. And they have, from Blackstone, the idea that the law either ratifies or violates natural law. That man's law can either ratify or violate what is natural law, what is actually true. So identity politics, Marxism, and all these theories that I disclose in my book are the antithesis of this. They agree with Kant, that man has rights that are given to him by the government. The government is the originator of rights. This is a product. We speak of the Enlightenment as if it had been something that happened in the 18th century that was monolithic. You have several Enlightenments. America is based more on Anglo-Scottish ideas and Anglo-Scottish thinkers, although they borrow from Montesquieu, obviously. And what this is based on is more the Continental Enlightenment, Kant and Diderot, and you know, thinkers that were either ambivalent about God or really, really hated God, hated religion. And then it goes through Hegelian dialectics, Nietzsche, Heidegger, and all that. This is a very continental thing, but they, even though they may not know it, they're also following dead white man. These are all European ideas.
Fascinating. So, okay, and your final chapter is actually now what, if I recall correctly?
It's solutions.
The question.
It's solutions. Look, I'll be frank with you. I see my main job with my book in exposing all of this, right? I expose what is happening, and I say, look what has happened. The overwhelming majority of Americans do not know this has happened. And then I say, you know, what kind of a problem is this? Is this a problem of a factory poisoning a river? Well, the first thing you need to do is shut off the factory, shut off the pipes, spewing these toxins into the river. And then after that, you go and you clean up the algae, you clean up the water. The factory in this case is government. Government was forced to create these categories. Government was through the courts, created the racial preferences of affirmative action in everything from university admissions to government contracting to hiring and so forth. You know, we need to get rid of all these things that create and then encourage group creation if we're going to get rid of groups and group thinking. By the way, this...
When you say, sorry, to get rid of groups, what do you mean exactly?
Like getting rid of the categories.
Of
the categories of identity politics.
Oh, got it.
Sorry, I should have said categories. And by the way, this was, again, completely what the civil rights movement demanded and was fought for, which was to have colorblind government. Amazingly enough, Kennedy's executive order 10925 in 1961, the first mention of affirmative action, he says he instructs federal contractors to make decisions without regard to race, national origin, or sex. And then within a few years, through alchemy by his successor, LBJ, it turns into making decisions that are based on race, national origin, or sex. So this is a complete reversal of Kennedy's original idea and what the civil rights movement was about.
Today, we have a lot of people that are, you know, concerned probably because they're just learning about all this stuff. For example, you know, the president calling out critical theory in the federal government. Critical theory is something that I think most Americans just haven't been familiar with. Myself included until somewhat recently in recent years. So the question is, what now, right? So we have to shut off the spigot?
Yes.
But what can the typical person do that's out there that's become concerned about this?
The typical person, I don't know, that even though he or she is not interested in critical theory is interested in her. Critical theory has completely taken over all of the universities. It's taught at different levels and through many different ways. The anti-racism training, the struggle sessions that workers are forced into doing is a result of critical theory. Everything that we see happening today are the direct result of critical theory. If you're in university or you have a son or granddaughter in university, they're studying critical theory. The chances are great that they are. In fact, from now on, to graduate from the California State University system, you have to have taken a course in ethnic studies. Ethnic studies is a form of critical theory. So everybody who goes through the California State system will have had to study critical theory. What the individual should speak up. The individual should say, "I don't want my children to be taught this." And just gaining understanding of this, rather than everybody wants to show their good intentions. Everybody wants to be a good person. What Americans need to understand is that virtue signaling is not the thing they should aim for. Is virtue practicing. It's practicing real virtues. We have the moral virtues that we practice of hard work, of delayed gratification. All these things are really what is important, not virtue signaling. But that will not get you anything. That will not make you a better person. That will not make you a better. That will not give you a better society.
You know, before we finish up, you actually lived in Hong Kong for a number of years.
Right.
You were the editor for the Wall Street Journal there.
I was the editor of the editorial page.
Right.
Right. For the Wall Street Journal in Asia. Yes, I'm horrified by what has happened to this great city. I lived there four different times under two different British governors, Wilson and Patton. and then under two Beijing-appointed rulers, C.H. Deng and Donnie Chang, I didn't think it would happen this quickly, that the communist government would start going back on its promise of one country, two systems, that it would destroy. So Hong Kong is a wonderful city. Hong Kong has a very high standard of living, higher than most American cities. Hong Kong is a free place where natural rights were respected. So the idea that anybody's going to tamper with this goose that laid the golden eggs for 150 years is horrifying. And I guess this will drive home the point to anybody who had any doubts that you cannot trust the Chinese Communist Party. And the Chinese Communist Party is obviously in charge of mainland China, suppresses the rights of 1.2 million, billion Chinese, and is trying, very busy now, trying to suppress the rights of 7 million Hong Kongers.
So is this what prompted you to research these possible connections between pro-CCP organizations and BLM?
No, not really. I understand the nature of communism. I was a foreign correspondent for 15 years, living mostly in Asia and Europe. I have done some reporting in Latin America as well. I'm very concerned about what is happening to our country, especially in the year of 2020. And I want to make sure that everybody understands what is really at stake here. What is being done, why, by whom and why.
And so in one sentence, what is at stake?
At stake is our freedom, our liberty. Are we going to continue living as Americans with the greatest prosperity and the greatest liberty ever known to man, or are we going to trade this in and act passively and allow it to happen?
Michael Gonzalez, such a pleasure to have you on the show.
The pleasure's all mine. Thank you very much.